and welcome to our Women's Walk with Christ vlog, Speaking Life. My name is Margaret Helton, and this is my co-host, Kim Turner.
Hello, and happy January 2021 to you all. I hope that your week has gotten off to a great start and that you had a wonderful weekend. So we're excited to have you all with us for another episode. We have a really wonderful special guest. We have our FFFFs for you and our G-walking, and it's just going to be a beautiful time that we are prepared to spend with you these next few minutes or so. So this week we have a very special guest, and she is one of our new sisters from the East Coast. She is our boots on the ground in the New England area, and here she is, Margaret Caine.
Hi, Margaret.
Hello, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for saying yes.
Yes.
How are things in the New England area, Boston area?
It is really cold right now, and we're supposed to get a lot of snow in the next couple days, so...
Oh no.
I think it's supposed to snow here tonight, but only like half an inch or something, not that much.
Yeah, they freak out for about like 2-3 inches. So that's, you would think that we would be better in New England, but we're definitely not.
Not. So here's a ridiculous question that I must ask. Is your husband happy for Tom Brady?
Yes and no. The Patriots season was pretty awful.
Right.
So he's bummed about that, but he, I think, would rather see Brady win the Super Bowl than Mahomes. So.
Oh.
And I'm anybody but Brady.
Right.
At this point.
You're not a Brady fan, huh?
Oh, no. I grew up in New York. I am a New York Giants fan through and through.
Yeah. I was watching it. I was like, I wonder how Patriots fans feel about Tom Brady now. Like, clearly it was more him than your coaches. That's
oh, yeah. Right. Oh, yeah.
So I would much rather see him lose too. So we'll see what happens.
Yeah.
Okay. So first, why don't you tell us when you did your weekend and then state your mission statement for us?
I did my weekend. Oof. North Carolina, I think it was 3 years ago, maybe 4 years ago, this fall. I can't remember. It's gone by so fast. And my mission statement is, as a restored woman walking with Christ, I co-create a world of authenticity and truth by pouring out love, joy, grace, and compassion.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
Thanks. Very nice.
And so our first question for you is, how has God changed your life through Women's Walk with Christ?
I think it's changed over time being in the ministry. At first it was, it kind of gave me a common ground and a way to talk to my husband because he had just gone through Marked Men. Mm-hmm. So it was like this language that we spoke at a time when our marriage desperately needed it. Mm-hmm. And that we were able to process and talk in kind of those terms, which was huge. But as it's gone on, it's kind of given me, it's challenged me as a woman and as a leader and as a person. It's made me really have to grow and lean into the Lord and realize that not everything is always about me. And sometimes people have their opinions and their thoughts and their desires, and it doesn't have anything to do with you. So that's really caused me to grow as a person and kind of see that part of myself that I really don't like, where I like want to take on everybody else's junk and everybody else's judgment, and it's not mine to take on. So God has grown me in huge ways through that, personally, through the ministry, that I don't think I would have gone through had I not been in Women's Walk.
That's awesome.
Do you find yourself, like, when you're looking at a situation or thinking about something, that you separated out, like, oh, that's data, oh, that's judgment, oh, those are the feelings? Mm-hmm. Like, in your mind, you process things differently too?
Yeah, I'm a teacher, and I came back after being quarantined with COVID for 20 something days because I have an autoimmune disorder. And I walked in and I was like, they hate me. Why are they acting like this? Why is there no joy in this classroom? And then I sat down, I was like, wait a minute. My data is, I'm feeling insecure because I left them in a hole. And then realizing, you know, I can only control what I can control. It was almost like I did my own little spirit circle on myself when my students were in Move to Learn.
It is. It's given I know I speak for myself. It's given me a lot of new tools just to look at different situations all the time. Mm-hmm. And I'm sometimes like, okay, Kim, you could really overreact to that because you're doing the same thing again. Okay, this is a better way to react.
Right.
So that's the one thing I think that has been really helpful for me is to learn new ways to respond.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You just did it and you didn't even know it. You said, I'll just speak for myself. That's a woman's walk thing too.
I know. I learned to do that all the time. And like, even with my husband, I'll be like, well, I know what I own from that is. And he's always like, why do you say that?
Right. Right. I definitely have to stop myself sometimes from saying like, I honor your truth in that. And I'm like, you're not going to understand me if I say that right now. So,
and in my brain, it sounds like the perfect thing to say.
Right. In a woman's walk circle, they would know exactly what I was saying.
Exactly.
It is hard. And I have to remember, oh yeah, not everybody's been on women's walk. Okay.
Right.
So right. I agree. It's a way that we can communicate with spouses that are marked men or significant others. But then also to each other, you know, like we just have common language. So that's interesting.
And it's kind of become, I use this term loosely, a little trendy. Like if you look into these, especially Christian women who are kind of coming up on this path of personal growth for other women, like Brené Brown and even like Beth Moore, a lot of the things that they use, they talk about authenticity and integrity and your personality development traits that you can use. And it's also women's walk.
Right.
Yeah, they're just coming to it. And we've been doing it for years.
Right. Right.
Yeah, so there.
It is really interesting, though. Like, I agree when you see other, like, our kind of flow through line in our language being used in other pieces. And it's mm-hmm. like, oh, yeah, I'm very familiar with that.
Right, right.
So that is a great segue into our next question for you is, what is one of your favorite Women's Walk with Christ agreements?
This is changed too. When I first started, I think I was so wounded and so hurt, especially by women, that I would say, oh no, my agreements are confidentiality and that above all, everything, that's what my favorite agreement is. And then someone said to me on a weekend, one of the wise women, she said, well, I always add this into my mission statement because this is the agreement I need to feel safe. And I was like, huh. And it made me think, and I looked at my mission statement, and I looked at the agreements, and I said, what do I need to feel safe? Mm-hmm. And my biggest thing was authenticity. Mm-hmm. I need to know that what I'm seeing is what I'm getting. Mm-hmm. And that you're the same person in front of me that you're going to be behind my back. To me, that above all is what I need from friends, family, coworkers, to feel safe and accepted and loved so that I can open up and I can pour out my gifts to other people.
Wow.
Which is also why it sits in my mission statement.
Yeah. I've never heard it said that way. That's a cool way to do that. Yeah. What a wise woman. Who told you that?
Am I allowed to say names?
You can. It's our
Rosemary Wicks.
Oh,
that's rough. Not surprising in the least. No?
She is wise.
Yes. And it was kind of like a passing comment. And I took it to heart and it really changed how I see everything.
Mm. Yeah. I've been thinking a lot about the agreements recently. I think don't know why. It's a bit come to mind. And so I posted something about it on Facebook a couple of days ago. And just like I hear them so many times, like on a weekend, and we say them every single time in spirit circle. And it's easy just to gloss over and not really think about the meaning. And so I think I'm going to just keep doing it and keep posting different agreements,
Yeah.
seeing what it means and just gathering insight from other people and how they interpret it.
I love that. And I love that's one of my favorite part about adding new women into our spirit circle is that we kind of get to do some intensive trust building around the agreements. And it's really, I would say, my favorite part because we learn more about each other, the older women and the new women who are coming in.
And it's a good reminder to keep those in front of us and reading them. Because like you say, sometimes it's you just read them because it's the motion. Oh, it's that time in the spirit circle to do this. But when you really read them and you listen to the words and you're like, okay. And I saw it on Facebook and I was like, I'm interested to see how people do take authenticity. What do they think of that word? This is what I think. And I've liked watching the comments. I haven't gotten on there today. I think you did honesty today. So I'm going
So
to get
we'll
on
see
there.
how it unfolds.
Yeah,
I
I
try not
like
to go on as often as I used to because it was, has been making me anxious, social media. So I've
I
been
honor your truth.
staying off
I like
a
look for
little
certain
and
people, and then I'm like, yeah, women's walk, I'll check women's walk.
smoothing people.
It can be daunting, for sure. Yeah. Okay. So our next question, which is a great segue. What is the most impactful thing a wise woman has told you or another sister has told you?
So that was one of them. And the other was really driving it home. And it was Lucy Gherkin, that when other people say things about you and when other people pass judgment about you, it's not yours and it's not yours to take on. And it was such a freeing thing. My mom passed away when I was 30 and kind of really missed that part of being an adult and those things that your mom would tell you. And just to have somebody repeatedly say to me, it's not yours to take on. You didn't do it. It's not yours to take on. This is an issue with them and not you. And that was like, it was so freeing to me to be able to just kind of look at it off to the side and not take it into my heart and believe those things about myself.
Yeah, which is hard. Like, say you always want to take that on and fix it. How do I fix it? But you can't fix what somebody's opinion is or what their judgment is. That's more about them, you know? And that is one of, we have a lady in our spirit circle, and she always says it not quite as eloquently, but it's always, that's their crap. Why do you want to pick up their crap? I'm like, you're right. Right? Like, I have so much of my own that I don't have time. And so it is freeing to be like, oh, yeah, that's totally you. I'll walk with you, but I don't have to pick it up.
And you can only control what's in your circle of control. And that's not what other people say about you, unfortunately. It'd be nice to be able to control that.
Nah, it's so much
But.
easier. It's like, I always say I'm not everybody's cup of tea, and that's okay. You know, it's all right.
Well, and sometimes, like for me, I know if something is said like to me or around me or something, like on a weekend, I like to physically like kind of wipe it off. Like I sometimes in parts of the weekend on Saturday, I do that every single time because it's like I overheard or I witnessed you doing something and I don't need to carry that around. Like I just need to like make sure that I physically like brush it off of me. And I think there's definitely a difference in just like saying it and then like doing an action so that it grounds you and so that you know like I'm not going to carry that out of this, you know.
Yeah, I've always visualized like a plexiglass shield between me and the person in front of me to not take on
That's really good.
those things.
Yeah, because it's like, so we have enough of our own, you know? Oh my gosh, if we took on everybody's, holy cow. I'd be laying on the pool on the floor in a mess.
You might have to get in the pool and wash it off.
Right, I'm serious. To be like, can I do my weekend again? I'm gonna start from scratch.
Right.
Okay, our next question is, are there other ministries you serve or volunteer in?
There are. I'm a youth group leader. I'm a senior high girls youth group leader for one more year because my boy enters into senior high next year and I refuse to be his youth group leader. So they got me for one more year. And I also play keyboard on the praise team at my church.
Ooh, that's cool.
I know, little known hidden facts.
We're ready.
Right. It's been a strange year. It's very disappointing, I think, for a lot of us.
Yeah, because like for me, I'll speak for me again. Because we always say this, when another woman does work, you do work, right? And so I get so much healing myself from the weekends. I'm like, man, I didn't realize how much I actually get from staffing.
Mm-hmm.
Until you don't get to anymore. And you're just like, something's missing. Oh, that's what's missing.
Right. And even though you're pouring out, you're also getting filled up. And I was talking to somebody the other day, and the relationships that you make with women all across the country in Women's Walk are unlike any other friendships you have anywhere, because there's never been time for like the crap, right down to like the meat and the dirty and everything that's in you, rather than kind of fluffing around. So you have these deep kind of intense friendships mm-hmm. that you wouldn't ever get anywhere else.
No, because they're agreeing to the agreements and you know that that's what right. you're going to do. And it's like, ah, I don't have to wear this mask today and that mask today and this one for you. Like, this is it.
Something we talked about with Rosemary a couple of months ago on the vlog when she was our guest is we talked about how it's so unique that there's so many generations within Women's Walk. You know, we have... Mm-hmm. Like I'm a millennial and, you know, I am very good friends with Rosemary, who's a baby boomer, you know, like in what other universe could she mm-hmm. be one of my dearest, closest friends? You know, like, it's just so unique that age doesn't really matter, you know, like maybe you have more life experience than me, but like, it doesn't matter how old you are. We can still have a deep, like meaningful connection with each mm-hmm. other.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I like that.
I love that part.
I think it's so important. And I think that's one of the reasons why I feel like my work in youth ministry with these high school girls kind of even ties into what I do in Women's Walk, because if we can build that foundation when mm-hmm. they're 14, 15, 16,
mm-hmm.
like how amazing would that be when they get to be 30, 40, 50?
Right.
We have some younger girls in our spirit circle and we all as olders, I always say, man, I wish I would have had this at your age. And right. when you're so new in your marriage, you know, like what a gift that you have that now, you know, I've struggled for 30 some years, you know, dealing with all this without it.
Mm-hmm.
And how different would my life have been if I would have been able to at a younger age? And so I love that for them. And I love to see all the younger girls that come on the weekends. I'm always like, ooh, yay. It's new.
Get ready.
Like, yay.
That's really great that you're working with the teenagers. I bet that you're just so life-giving to them and speaking truth and speaking life into their lives. And I can't imagine being a teenager right now. Like,
no, it's awful. Talk about anxiety. Like there's so much social pressure mm-hmm. to be something you're not all the time. Like they were telling me if they put a post up on Instagram and they don't get 100 likes in like a half an hour, they take it down because that means people don't like them. And yeah. I'm like, oh my gosh, the only time I've ever gotten 100 likes about anything was like when my dad died and friends were supporting me. I can't even imagine. I can't imagine being that. It's heartbreaking. The things that they deal with on a daily basis are so different. And I'm a millennial too. I'm 40. I just turned 40 this year. So it's like, that wasn't that long ago, but it's so different.
Yeah.
It's so different.
Right. And to think that's one thing they're focusing on, how many likes you get.
How many likes? Or like they're always on, because somebody could be filming you at any time when you don't know it.
Yeah. Right. And then they just post it. Yeah. Well, I am very grateful that they have you in their lives to speak truth, and that you're helping them build some really good foundational building blocks. That's a real blessing.
Thanks. I don't know if they feel that way sometimes when I come down on them for boyfriends or alcohol or any of those lovely things that they want to out, but
in 10 or 15 years, they'll realize what a blessing you are.
Exactly. You're just planting the little mustard seed, and it's going to grow. And then they'll look back and they'll be like, remember our youth group leader, Margaret? Yeah. He was the best. So you're building the future. That's huge.
Hopefully.
Yeah, it is.
Well, so on to our last question. And I'm very excited to announce to our viewers that Margaret would like to talk about the Enneagram, and she is not an Enneagram 2. We
yes!
have our first new number besides 2. Would you like to tell everyone what number you are and how you came about the Enneagram and what you like about it?
I am a 4 with a 5 wing, and I'm not 100, I'm still so new at this. I'm not 100% sure what all of it means, but it definitely piqued my interest. Somebody posted something, I think it was my daughter, and she was saying, oh, you should take the test. You should take the test. And I'm like, all right, whatever. So I did. And I'm like, at first I was like, this is 100% me. 100% me. It's like you appear confident on the outside, but you really care about everything everybody says about you on the inside. And your desire to please and to kind of be perfect tends to weigh out, but you also feel very abandoned when people don't give it back to you. So it's kind of this push and pull from what I can tell. Like I said, I'm still very, very new. Authenticity comes up a lot in the Enneagram 4. Yeah. And the other part I felt really connected to is there's this fear of not belonging that the 4 is fear. And that to me, that's so me. Mm-hmm. Like I'm always afraid. I've got big time FOMO about just about everything.
A little bit more about the 4, that a 4 is an individualist, usually an artist, a romantic, and a special one. Are you very romantic?
No.
Okay. Okay.
I guess a little, but that's not, I wouldn't say that's my main thing.
Okay. But from what you're saying, so the 2s, 3s, and 4s are in the heart triad, and then the 5, 6, and 7 is in the head triad, like they're thinkers, and then the 8, 9, and 1, they're in the gut triad. And so the heart triad, you're talking a lot about feelings and the people pleasing part of you. That's a 2. A 2 is a really big people pleaser. And everybody else's needs are a lot more important than my needs. And so you probably have some 2-ness in you as well. But just that feeling, like when you hear information first, or when you like are talking to someone, you're more in touch with like the emotional side, as opposed to like the intellectual side or like the, you know, the instinct side. You rely a lot on your feelings when you're talking to someone.
Right. And I think that's why I wing 5, because I do have that science brain.
Yeah.
So from what I was reading, that when you wing 5, it's like the bohemian, and you are a little more cerebral with your feelings.
Yeah. Definitely. And then some affirmations that 4s feel sometimes. And again, this isn't, it's not an all-inclusive thing, because you may connect with this and you may not, but 4s often, the affirmation is, I will value each day no matter how ordinary it is. Like you're really intentional with your feelings. And that you desire to be yourself and to find your significance.
Yeah. That sounds about right.
Okay. And then the other thing we found as we were talking, as we were prepping, that there's some famous people that are fours. And it's always interesting because, you know, like these are just on random websites and you really only know, like, if these people need to take the test to see, but it's just like their outward appearance into the world and their public projection. These people have been identified as fours just based on their actions in the world. So Anne Frank was a four. Edgar Allan Poe was a four. Gene Wilder and Kate Winslet.
Kind of that's an interesting mix of people.
Yeah.
A very broad mix of people.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm still learning a lot about it too. We had Rhonda White on the show 2 weeks ago, and she is, I would call her an expert. Like, she's been to conferences and she's read like all kinds of books, and she listens to podcasts, and she's just, it's so fluid in her mind about, oh, this is how a four relates to a two. And, you know, she was even doing it with us. Like, this is how twos connect with nines, 'cause Kim's a nine, you know? And so I have to kind of look up like, which one is that again? But I think it's just really interesting just really interesting self-discovery, like you were saying, like some of the things, that's exactly me, but some of the things aren't, you know?
I mean, I was reading a lot about it because I had taken it, but I was kind of like, my daughter kept telling me, you're four, you're four, you're four. And I'm like, I don't know which, I have a daughter who's 26. So she's old enough to kind of get it. And I loved that the basic fear of a four, and this is so me, is that you have no identity or personal significance. And I feel that. So I so badly want to make a difference. And I think that's why I went into teaching, and that feeling of not making a difference, it like kills me. That's the one that really got me.
I feel like my mission statement really helps give me identity, so that like when someone says, who are you, or what do you stand for? Like, I know exactly, I can say, I'm a woman walking with Christ and I co-create a world. Like, I can just rattle it off in my mind and I can use pieces of that to communicate to other people, non women walk people, about, you know, like who I am and what I'm about and why I'm breathing, like why God's giving me breath today.
Right.
Yeah. So I really valued that with my mission statement. So great. Well, we thank you so much. And I guess the last question I have for you, I wanted to ask you this at the beginning and I forgot, but where does your name come from? Were you named Margaret after someone special?
I was. It's kind of tragic. My mother's sister was killed when she was 13. And her name was Margaret, and I'm named after her.
Okay.
I have a very Irish name. I'm not Irish at all. I am almost 100% Italian. So I don't know how I got to be Margaret Eileen Caine. Very, very, very Irish, but I am not. I'm not.
That's interesting, because I was named after my great aunt Margaret. My grandfather's sister was Margaret. And so that's why my mom picked Margaret. So it's usually an older person name.
Yeah.
Not for
and
us.
It's so interesting to meet somebody else who actually goes by Margaret.
Right.
Instead of Maggie or Meg or Peggy or whatever 100 other nicknames there are for Margaret.
Right. Well, and how you get Peggy from Margaret, I'm not too sure. I've never understood that.
And there's a lot of people that do. I'm always like, what is your name? It's not your name.
Right.
So now the part of our show we will move on to is the the funny fuel for Fridays. So these are kind of just rapid questions about your favorite things or funny things or your fuzz. So what is your favorite meal, breakfast, lunch, or dinner? And is it from a restaurant or is it homemade?
There is this little burger shop down in Newport, Rhode Island, right on the beach, called Mission Burger, and they make the most amazing burger you've ever had. And that is my favorite meal.
There's nothing like a good burger.
Right.
How often do you have it?
Not very often, because it's 40 minutes away. And if you know anything about New England, they don't go 40 minutes away. My husband's born and raised here. So like Newport's a day trip. We pack dog because you can't drive 40 minutes to go anywhere. Now, upstate New York is 20 minutes to the grocery store, and they just don't understand that here.
I have heard that they don't like to travel far.
No. It's like you have to plan your day at the beach because it's a 40-minute drive. I'm like, 40 minutes to get to the beach? That's amazing.
That's like a one. Are you kidding?
I'll go every day. Yeah.
That's so funny. Okay, our next what is your favorite or worst movie you've seen?
My favorite movie is It's a Wonderful Life. I just love that movie. That's everything about it. Cry every time I watch it, laugh every time I watch it. I think the worst movie I've ever seen, probably one of the ones my son has made me watch, one of those Disney movies. I think High School Musical ranks up there pretty high.
That's a rough one.
That would be my daughter who made us watch that one. So
you're in that world. I don't have to watch movies like that. Nobody asks me to watch movies like that.
Oh, right. If they ever ask you to watch a Power Ranger movie, don't.
Those are bad.
Don't do it.
Those are really bad.
Right?
Or anything with Alvin and the Chipmunks. I cannot stand Alvin and the Chipmunks. I think it's the voices that just get to me. And my son used to love them when he was younger. Now he's out of that, but
that's funny.
Like nails on the chalkboard.
Yeah. And a very unpopular opinion. I do not find Seinfeld funny at all. Like, not even a little. I can't pay attention. I can't focus on it. I'm just like, why? My husband is like, well, it's funny because it's a show about nothing. I'm like, I don't find it funny. And I'm from New York. Like, I just don't.
I never really watched that show. I've just seen clips of it. But
my husband just started trying to get me to watch it like last week, him and a couple of friends. And I just can't. I can't get into it.
Okay, well then I won't even invest my time.
I don't mind stupid humor, but it makes like nothing ties in together. It just makes no sense to my Enneagram 4 brain. It doesn't make any sense to it.
Okay, good to know. Okay, so what's the most fun thing that you've done during the pandemic or during your quarantine so far?
So this summer, my family, the men in my family are part of this ministry out here called Road Trip, like R-H-O-D-E trip. And it is a 6-year young men's, Christian leadership wilderness ministry.
Wow.
So they start the summer before going into 8th grade, and every other trip was canceled because of COVID, except for my son's trip, which was trip 1. And they go to New Hampshire, to Mount Garfield. And my husband did the last trip, trip 6, Valentine's Day weekend of 2020. And they went to Nicaragua. They actually go to Colorado in year 4. And year 2, they hike Mount Katahdin in Maine, which is a really high peak. I think they go canoeing year 3, and then they do some bivouacking year 4. And year 5, they head out to Colorado.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a really cool program. But our son got to go for the first time, which meant that we were alone, and some very dear friends let us use their condo in Vermont. So we went up to Vermont for the week, just the two of us, and like did nothing. Read and hiked and ate and just enjoyed being alone for a little while with little cell reception. So that was probably the best thing I've done.
Oh, that sounds wonderful.
That sounds like perfect.
It was.
Just to escape you two together. Oh, so nice.
Yeah. It was fun. Great.
And I hear Vermont's beautiful. I've never been.
It's amazing. It really is beautiful. There's not a ton to do. And we don't like being outside, but we do. So it was perfect.
How pretty. How far is that from where you are?
We went up to Londonderry, which is about halfway up in the state. And it's about 2.5 hours, 3 hours.
Oh, that's not too bad.
Yeah, not bad at all.
Oh, that sounds wonderful. All right, our last question. If you didn't have to worry about making a living, what would your dream job be?
I've kind of always wanted to open a gluten-free food truck.
Really?
Yeah. My 14-year-old has celiac disease, and he's had it since he was four. So there's a lot of food that he's never been able to eat. Like, he just had an Oreo for the first time, guys, ever. Like, a real Oreo for the first time this week. Because they finally made gluten-free Oreos.
Oh.
And we love going. They have this big food truck event in Providence, and we love going, but he can never eat anything. So I was like, how cool would it be to create a gluten-free food truck that had really good tasting food? So that's kind of, if I didn't have to do that, if I didn't have to worry about money, I'd love to do that. But I really love teaching kids how to read. So, yeah. And I get to do that and get paid for it. So it's kind of a win-win situation.
So you're kind of doing your dream job in a way.
I am. Right.
Cool. Well, what a great idea. That would probably be the longest line.
Yeah. You probably have a lot of customers.
Right.
Seriously. Like, there's so many people now that are gluten-free that it amazes me. But there's also more variety. I'm sure when you first with your son, you couldn't find anything.
Nothing. Yeah. It was like begging people to cook a hamburger in a pan, not on the grill, and not putting sides. And then like worrying, okay, are we going to get sick? Like, is it going to be a bad night? So we didn't go out a lot because of it. But now it's pretty popular. You can find something almost anywhere.
Yeah. And it seems like people are really good about like marking it like this is gluten-free or this is dairy-free or, you know, like people are, seems like they're doing better, but like restaurants are doing better.
Yeah. Yeah. We've been pretty lucky up here, but
that's something I never would have thought about. Like cookies, like Oreos, like gluten in them. Like, it's like sneaky how they put gluten in stuff. Like, what, how did it get there?
Yeah. Or like fish and chips. He had fish and chips for the first time last summer. He'd never had fish and chips before because fried fish is breaded. And a lot of French fries are cooked in the same fryer as food that's breaded, so he would never get to eat it. So it's simple things like having French fries would be huge.
That would be fun. That would be actually a fun time, having a food truck.
Right. And I don't want to talk to any of the people. My husband would be like the front man selling food and talking to people. I'll just cook it. Like, if I don't have to talk to people, I'm fine. But
yeah, tell us.
I'm an introverted extrovert.
So say that again. You're an introverted extrovert?
Introverted extrovert. I want to be I want to be included in the situation, but I don't actually want to go.
Okay.
Yeah,
included, but you're just not sure you want to go.
Yeah, sometimes I'd rather just sit at home, but I want the invite anyway to know that I have the option of going.
And your husband, we're glad
you accepted our invitation.
Is your husband an extrovert?
Oh my gosh, yes. Yeah, he's a salesman. He's been in construction sales. Now he works in the management team at REI. Like, he just loves people.
So he could just like take a cardboard cutout of you to parties. And so you're there, but you're not really there.
Yeah. Yeah. Our daughter thought it was really funny to say that song that was popular by Justin Bieber and Ed Sheeran. I don't like anybody but you. I hate everyone here. They're like, oh my gosh. She's like, that's your song. Dan drags you to parties. Yeah. Dan drags you to parties and you just stay there with him.
Great, thanks.
That's probably where your Enneagram 5 wing comes in. Like, I think that's why they don't really want to be out in the world.
No, but the 4 makes me want to be included and not want to not be included. So
this tug of war thing going on.
Exactly.
That's funny. Oh my goodness.
Well, we are so appreciative that you said yes to our invitation and that we got to know more about you. And we really hope that we see you soon in person,
Yeah,
live, not just on
I know.
a
Well, thanks for thinking of me and having me.
Zoom. Yeah, we're like, we need East Coast. We are East Coasting it.
You're
Coast.
representing.
Yes. And we're all hoping and praying that we'll have a weekend there soon. I know we're working on that. So hopefully
We're
we'll be
pretty much
coming to
still shut
you.
down, so the search has been slow going because everywhere's still closed. Massachusetts just reopened little by little this week. Like we're pretty locked down here in the Northeast still, so
Wow, how different it is, because here we're
I know.
starting to loosen up a little bit, you know? So it's like you
No.
just never. Oh. Well,
Like
we are.
our church is still at 25% capacity because like just gathering restrictions are still so tight in the area that they're it's been tough.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully we're moving forward, I'm hoping.
Moving through it.
Yes, we're moving through it. So, yes, thank you so much for taking the time to spend with us. It was wonderful. And we do hope to see you soon this
Yeah,
year.
hopefully May.
Yeah, fingers crossed.
Hello.
Thanks, Margaret. It was nice talking to
Bye.
you.
Thank
Bye.
you.
Bye.
A four. Yay.
I told you someday we would have someone on the show that wasn't an Enneagram 2, and now it's happened.
Yay. I'm
And
so glad we invited her. It's somebody very different for both of us, and I think that's wonderful.
I learned a lot about like introverted extroverts. I've never heard that term, but it makes sense. Like you want to be there, but you don't really like you're emotionally you want to be there to be connected and included, but physically you don't want to be
I
there.
want to be there. Which was cool to make the connection between the four and the five. That's cool.
Yeah.
It's like,
And
huh?
those it's interesting. I would be interested to hear what Rhonda has to say about it, that like you're in one triad with your main number four, like in the heart triad, but then you're in like a head space,
Head.
head triad with your wing. Like that's probably an interesting dance and all always this like kind of tug of war thing.
Within yourself. That's interesting.
Right? 'Cause like mine, I'm a two with a three wing, so I'm still in my same little triad. So
Say I'm a nine, and I think I'm a nine with a three.
okay, so you have so it could be the same for you too. You're a gut person that has the feeling wing.
Which I found interesting because I'm always like a gut person. I never really thought of myself that way. I always think I'm a heart person. So it's like that part I always kind of struggle with, but I'm like,
But I think you have really good instincts and you have really good intuition, and that's what makes you a gut person.
I must be, I just have to be better about trusting my gut, is what I've been told by people. If that, if you feel that, that's what you, your intuition, you should go with that. And it's like, ah, I doubt my own intuition, you know.
Don't ignore the big red flags.
No, but you know, it's even like when you hear people say, oh, you're wise. I'm like, who are they talking to? Somebody standing behind me? That's just
No.
right. But you don't like sometimes you're just like, well, I would never think of that for myself. Interesting. Okay.
That's why we have sisters, so that we can see what others see in us.
Exactly.
All right. So we will continue with our FFFFs, our faithful fuel for Fridays. So our verse today will come out of Matthew 4. And this is a little bit longer. We're going to go 1 through 11. So hang in there with me. And then we'll talk about it a little bit after I read this. So this is out of the NIV. And this is about how Jesus was tested in the wilderness. So Matthew 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell the stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and it had and had him stand at the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, that they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is also written, do not put your Lord God to the test. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All this I will give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And then the devil left him and angels came and attended to him. So the reason I picked this verse, I'm doing a new study called Matchless by Angie Smith. And this was part of the study, and it's a study about Jesus and his life and his legacy and how he loved people. And it's called Matchless, The Life and Love of Jesus. And so I was reading through all of this and how Jesus, you know, this is kind of one at the beginning of Matthew of the Gospels about how Jesus was tempted kind of before his healing and his preaching and his teaching journey began. He was tempted. And so I was struck by some of the things that she said. And again, this is by Angie Smith, which is a Lifeway devotional. And she said that it's easy to avoid desire if you're in a position of little need. And so she said, she kind of made the parallel that Jesus had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And then the Bible says he was hungry. So he had a physical need. He was hungry. And so he was in a state, you know, where he could be easily, you know, like compromised because of a physical need. And so he was talking about, she says that the enemy is going to wait until trouble is already brewing. He's not going to try and attack you when everything is great and life is good, because you can easily say, get away from me, Satan, you know, but if you're already in a compromised state, he waits until we are desperate, lonely, doubting, and depressed. He waits until we have reason to believe that God has chosen not to rescue us from our salvation. He waits until we have more weakness than faith, and then he bursts wide open the door that we don't always realize that we've left cracked open for him to enter.
Wow.
I know. I underlined it.
Can you read that again?
So he waits until we are desperate, lonely, doubting, and depressed. He waits until we have reason to believe that God has chosen not to rescue us from our salvation. He waits until we have more weakness than faith. And then he bursts wide open the door that we don't always realize that we've left cracked open for him.
Wow.
So I guess after reading this and studying this, my encouragement this week is just that if you're having the COVID blues, if you're down and you're over it and you're ready to get back to some kind of normal, this is the time where we need to be on guard the most. When we're already low and down, that's when we need to be more aware that the evil one is trying to slither in and weasel in and make you believe things that aren't true, and make you doubt God. And so I encourage you to be aware of your emotional state of being and how it could be taken advantage of.
And if you feel that way, to make sure that you have somebody that you can reach out to and talk to somebody and be able to process that through with, you know, because we can't get through this life without having community and other people to help support us. And so if we live in that pit and we stay there, that's exactly where the evil one wants us, right? He wants us to stay there and decorate your pit, because he doesn't want us to get out and to continue to see that there is light and that there is God, because he's still there, but he doesn't want us to hear that. And so I really encourage that if you're feeling at that place right now, and it seems like everybody kept saying, oh, I can't wait for 2021. It's the new year. It's going to be better. And it just hasn't gotten that way yet for some people. And that's okay, but you don't have to stay that way. And so I really strongly encourage anybody that's struggling to reach out to anybody. And you don't have to tell your whole story. We always say that you don't have to know someone's whole story to just be there. And so if someone does reach out for you, just be that ear to listen. Some people just want to be heard. And if they can just talk about it, it helps them to empty that cup, and so that they can fill it back up with something new. So be aware of your own darkness and your own cracks in your door, but also about the people around you, you know, and help if you can, you know. And like I say, sometimes it's just a listening ear, but that allows you to then breathe some life into them. So be aware of that for others too. And I mean, look, even they were trying to tempt Jesus, for Pete's sake, you know, like he will try to tempt anybody and to take you to that place. And we just have to be more like Jesus, you know,
and in lots of different ways, right? Lots of tricky ways, and repeatedly, three different times he tempted Jesus, you know? So it's like, yeah, Jesus had to be steadfast and to recognize the trickery and the deceit, even when he was having a physical need. Like he was hungry. He was tired. Like he was probably experiencing lots of, like, and that's why he came to earth, right? To be able to experience life as a human, but in, you know, in as a holy being. So he wanted to be able to be relatable and experience, you know, what we experience in life every day. So.
Yeah. And it's hard. I mean, I'm sure three times. And I mean, he had to tell him how many times. And so you got to be vigilant about that. And I know it's tough, especially like you say, when you're sitting here and it's, you can't leave your house and you can't do this and you can't do that. It's easy to stay in that dark, but you just got to find some positive, you know, and it's hard to do sometimes, but I will again speak for myself, especially to all the women that watch, but I'm always here for somebody if they want to just reach out and just listen. I'm great at listening. And I know Margaret would say the same thing. So, I mean, if you're feeling like you're in that place and you need something, really, we're just a simple email away or a comment away. And don't let yourself get stuck in that pit.
Absolutely.
Because that's not healthy for you or for your family. And we don't want you to stay there.
Right. So. And go back and watch old vlogs. They're all on YouTube or on Facebook. And it's very good for the soul. It's good for our souls, and we hope that it's good for your souls too.
Yes, that is the main purpose for our show, is we want to give some positivity for your day and to help with this time and this transition. And so hopefully we're giving each of you a little bit of a mustard seed that helps you get through a couple of weeks.
So this part of our show is a new segment that we just started at the beginning of this year called G-Walking, God on the Ground. I had a realization after last time's episode, that we like Fs and we like Gs. Eventually we're going to have to spread out to different letters in the alphabet. But for now, we like Fs and we like Gs.
It's right in our wheelhouse.
We like the first half of the alphabet a lot.
Yeah, because it was A, B, C, D, E, F, G's first.
That's true. We did also do A, B, C, D, E, F's.
We're broadening our alphabet, okay? We're
slowly expanding down the alphabet to G. So our G-walking story, I'll share mine this week. And I've actually already shared it with you, but I didn't tell you this beforehand. I was listening to the radio, and kind of like I was talking about the agreements, like you just hear it so many different times that it's like, I just, you know, sometimes it's just like autopilot, like I don't really listen to the words. And so I was listening to the radio and the song came on that I'm sure I've heard 1,000 times. And it was the song that I sent you, that God gave me you. And I just like was struck that, you know, God gave me you, Kim Turner, my hobbit, that God knew that I would be in this COVID season and struggling with needing personal connections. And he brought you into my life for this very moment and for this very reason. And I couldn't do this life without you. And so I'm just so grateful that God gave me you for the ups and downs. Right. So I love you.
I love you too. I didn't know I was going to be the G-walking.
You're the G-walking this week because God gave me you. So definitely go on YouTube and listen to the song. because it's a really great song. I think there's a couple different people that sing it, but it's a I really, really like that song.
And I love
you this week.
Well, I know that that's why he gave me you. You allow me to step out of my comfort zone and you challenge me all the time, especially with this little thing we're doing together, way outside my comfort zone. But I'm like, all right, Margaret said it. All right, I'll try it.
What else could we do? No.
No. Stop listening, Margaret. But I think you're right. And I am very thankful for you and very blessed to have had you in my life for so many years.
So we encourage all of you to think about the G-walking moments in your life and think about how God shows up in your everyday life and be attuned to things that maybe you've heard 1,000 times, like a song or a verse or the agreements or something, you know, even the words I love you from somebody that you love. Just be extra attuned to what that really means and be hypersensitive to all that is going around in your life.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Margaret. So yes, post your G-walking. We're waiting. We do look at them and we would love to share some if you have one for our next show. So please post them in the comments.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for joining us for another episode of Speaking Life. We hope that we've given you some laughs and some inspiration and hopefully something to think about until the next time we get together.
Yes, absolutely. And as Kim said, thank you so much for watching and for supporting us. And we love to hear from you. So give us a thumbs up or a like or a comment below, whether you're watching on YouTube or Facebook. And we'll see you next time.
Have a great couple weeks.
Bless you.